Welcome to worship at McFarland Lutheran Church, our sanctuary, live today on July 26th. Great for you to be with us today as we give thanks to God for the blessings of today and we worship and praise God together. There is a bulletin for this service that is available for you on the website or on Facebook. So if you'd like to follow along with the words for the liturgy, please check that out. Also on our website, we just put our Vacation Bible School package. The way the Children and Youth Ministry team have designed it this year is for parents and children to do that in their homes, which is a great way of cultivating faith development in the home. So please check that out. It's a great theme, great package. It's on our McFarland Lutheran Church website. Today at 11 o'clock, we will be doing our annual meeting at McFarland Lutheran Church. We'll be right outside in the area between the Rainbow Center and the office building. So come bring a lawn chair if you'd like, have your mask. We're going to stay physically distant, but we will do some important work together, which includes voting in new council members and approving our operating ministry budget, and bring your water. It's going to be hot out, but we're going to make it quick so nobody dies of heat stroke. Yay! So if you can join us at 11 o'clock, we're over outside. In a few weeks, Pastor Kelly and I will be convening conversations on racism. We are going to be doing two Zoom conversations on racism, August 5th and August the 12th, from 7 to 8 p.m. on Zoom. We'll be putting out a link for that on our Zoom account. You can also email either Pastor Kelly or myself for that. We'll be doing watching a video that our bishop, Peter Rognes, has done with a local African-American pastor, Everett Mitchell, of Christ the Solid Rock Church in Madison. Their dialogue that they had together was excellent and a springboard for us to talk about the real complex issues of racism. So I hope you join us for those conversations. We will have more information about that in our e-news, our weekly e-news, and we'll announce it in the weeks to come. Now, we continue our worship with the confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who whose steadfast love is everlasting, whose faithfulness endures from generation to generation. Amen. Trusting in the mercy of God, let us confess our sin. Reconciling God, we confess that we do not trust your abundance and we deny your presence in our lives. We place our hope in ourselves and rely on our own efforts. We fail to believe that you provide enough for all. We abuse your good creation for our own benefit. We fear difference and do not welcome others as you have welcomed us. We sin in thought, word, and deed. By your grace, forgive us, through your love, renew us, and in your spirit, lead us, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life. Amen. Beloved of God, by the radical abundance of divine mercy, we have peace with God through Christ Jesus, through whom we have obtained grace upon grace. Our sins are forgiven. Let us now live in hope, for hope does not disappoint, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Please join in singing our gathering song, number 532. Gather us in.
Here in this place, the moonlight is streaming down. the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Beloved and sovereign God, through the death and resurrection of your Son, you bring us into your kingdom of justice and mercy. By your Spirit, give us your wisdom, that we may treasure the life that comes from Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Our first reading comes from Romans, the 8th chapter. The Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought. But that very Spirit intercedes with sighs too deep for words. And God, who searches the heart, knows what the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. We know that all things work together for good for those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn within a large family. And those whom he predestined, he also called, and those whom he called, he also justified, and those whom he justified, he also glorified. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not withhold his own Son, but gave him up for all of us, will he not with him also give us everything else? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died, yes, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Word of God, word of life. The Holy Gospel according to Matthew, the 13th chapter. Jesus put before the crowds another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed that someone took and sowed in his field. It is the smallest of all the seeds, but when it has grown, it is the greatest of shrubs and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air come and make nests in its branches. He told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and mixed in with 3 measures of flour until all of it was leavened. The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field, which someone found and hid. Then in his joy, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. On finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and caught fish of every kind. When it was full, they drew it ashore, sat down, and put the good into baskets and threw out the bad. So it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them into the fire, furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you understood all this? They answered, yes. And he said to them, therefore, every scribe who has been trained for the kingdom of heaven is like the master of a household who brings out of his treasure what is new and what is old. The Gospel of the Lord. Over the past couple of weeks, we have heard Jesus compare the kingdom of heaven to a sower who tosses seeds on 4 different types of soil and to wheat that grows among weeds. Today, we get 5 more short stories. This time using the images of a mustard seed, some yeast, hidden treasure, a fine pearl, and a fishing net, all to spark our imaginations when it comes to envisioning what the kingdom of heaven is like. This is, for the time being, our final dive into the parables. We are introduced to an assortment of people in this collection. We meet a sower of seed, a woman baking bread, a fortune seeker, a merchant, and a commercial fisher. You may have noticed that these positions aren't of global, cultural, religious, or governmental significance. Jesus chose to describe the kingdom of heaven through pretty ordinary people doing pretty ordinary jobs. The kingdom doesn't necessarily reveal itself through a hierarchy that this world values, but rather, the kingdom is within reach and accessible for all people. The kingdom is not unattainable, incredible, or unrelatable, but common, familiar, and close at hand. The kingdom of heaven is all around us. It is infused into everything we do, like spending time in nature, preparing meals, dreaming for the future, engaging in commerce and working. There is no division between what is the kingdom and what isn't. In the words of one author, the ordinariness of the tasks invites us to see signs of the kingdom of heaven in our day-to-day lives, to recognize that it is emerging in our very midst. The kingdom is all around us and permeates everything we do. So for me, the kingdom of heaven is like a canoe ride with my family. Paddling with my 3-year-old is a lot of fun, but I would not describe it as calm or relaxing. There are goldfish crackers or granola bars or water bottles to distribute, only after discussing their varying merits. There are birds and fish and lily pads and trees to locate, point out, and identify. There are songs to sing and questions to ask. It's loads of fun, and I love our adventures, but I wouldn't necessarily advertise it as peaceful. These typical excursions are plenty reflective of the kingdom, but there was one time, a few weeks ago, we were out and Theo was laying down in the bottom of the canoe on some towels all jammed into his little kid life jacket, and he was calm. He was quiet. Mike and I were just slowly paddling and just enjoying the moment. There was a bright blue sky. It was a crystal clear morning. I was at the front of our boat, and the Ahara River was relatively wide at this point, and there was no one else around. I couldn't stop lifting my head back, feeling the sun on my face, marveling at the cloudless sky, and drinking in breaths of air, fresh, clean air. It was as if I could see the arc of the dome of the sky. There were birds singing, a few bullfrogs grunted now and again, and there was the quiet lap of the water as we paddled our way back to the car. I could feel the expansiveness, yet the closeness of the kingdom of heaven. And the kingdom of heaven is like no-touch baptisms, a liturgical piece that Pastor Tim and I are thrilled to be doing once again. I've preached a number of times about how much I love doing baptisms. I love the feel of the water dripping down my arm all the way to my elbow. I love tracing the cross on the wee one's forehead as they are marked by God's love forever. I love seeing the parents smile, wondering how the baby will react, and trying to notice how many grandparents have tears of joy. I love walking from the back in the font to the font in the back all the way up front as the child symbolically enters the community. I love the assembly that gathers together, that promises to love and support the parents and the child, and all that clap when we introduce the newest member of the family of God. But this is the time of COVID. And just because there are things that I love and that I want, that doesn't mean that they are safe or wise to do. I won't get to feel the water because we're using a seashell. There's no feel of oil, at least for me anyway. That task is given to a family member. There's no way to tell who is smiling behind their mask, no walking to the front, no huddled groups for photos. And while there is a small representation of the community here and a larger one online, there is no collective of our community who is gathered physically together in this space. And while I will argue all day long that those things are important, and I can't wait for them to be a part of our worship life again, the Spirit's creativity has showed us how to still celebrate baptisms. God still gives us water. God still calls parents to bring their child to the sacrament. God still makes us a child of God. God still showers us with the promise to always love us, forgive us, and never leave us. God still gathers a community together, just in a new way now. And God still calls us to surround this child with love and care on their journey of faith. And it is beautiful. And there will still be tears of joy. The kingdom of heaven looks like no-touch baptisms in a time of pandemic. The kingdom of heaven is all around us. The kingdom of heaven is like someone who prints off church's devotional materials so a friend who doesn't have a computer can still participate in the life of this church. The kingdom of heaven is like someone who orders their sister a pizza when their child has the stomach flu because planning and preparing dinner for the healthy ones in the house feels impossible. The kingdom of heaven is like emptying the dishwasher or cleaning off the counter. The experience of accomplishing something concrete when the world feels so chaotic. The kingdom of heaven is like getting a card or a text or email or a little gift from a dear friend. Not anything big, and not for any reason in particular other than they care. The kingdom of heaven is like someone who reads about a different life experience or who watches a documentary about an unfamiliar reality in our world and who lets that information widen their understanding and maybe even change their opinion. The kingdom of heaven is like someone who continues to volunteer in our community or who supports local and global organizations that are taking care of those who are hit hardest at this time. The kingdom of heaven is like groups of people, church committees maybe, who are intentionally staying connected and checking in with one another, who are thinking outside the box and brainstorming how we can pivot our energies and still be the church and still continue to share the love of God with the world. People who continue to pray for and financially support the ministries of the congregation they love and of the congregation who loves them. My goodness. The kingdom is everywhere. We can't go off and look for it and then leave it and come back home because it is already everywhere. The fortune seeker in our parable found the hidden treasure accidentally, and the merchant found the pearl intentionally. The kingdom is near whether we know where to find it or happen to stumble upon it. And we know where we can look for the kingdom. We know our chances are good when we go to worship or engage scripture or attend a Bible study or participate in community. God has let us know there are some rather reliable places where we can recognize the kingdom's presence and activity. But there are still times when its presence will catch us delightfully off guard, like when we're on the water and look up at the sky, welcome a child into the life of faith, print off church devotionals, order a pizza, empty the dishwasher, or check the mail. When we are grieving and feel powerless and have no control, and when we're tired of being quarantined and we're aching by the number of people who are sick and getting dying, and we want nothing more than to make real eye contact and give someone a hug, when it feels like the kingdom is nowhere to be found, or at least it's somewhere far, far away, we can trust that the kingdom of heaven is still here, even if all we see is bread and not the yeast, or all we see is a tree and forget about the seed. It really is everywhere. So the kingdom of heaven is like a canoe ride. The kingdom of heaven is like a touchless baptism. What is the kingdom of heaven like for you? Thanks be to God. Amen.
Please join in singing our number 793, Be Thou My Vision.
Thank you.
And speaking of baptisms, we get to celebrate the baptism of Harvey Radloff. God, who is rich in mercy and love, gives us a new birth into a living hope through the sacrament of baptism. The power of sin is put to death in his holy flood, and we are raised with Jesus Christ to new life. We are united with all the baptized in the one body of Christ, anointed with the gift of the Holy Spirit, and sent out in mission for the life of the world. Today, you're presenting Harvey for baptism. Tony and Lindsay, trusting in the grace and love of God, do you desire to have Harvey baptized? If so, please answer, we do. Tony and Lindsay, as you present Harvey for baptism, you are entrusted with gifts and responsibilities to live with him among God's faithful people. Bring him to the Word of God and the Holy Supper. Teach him the Lord's Prayer, the Creed, and the Ten Commandments. Place in Harvey's hands the Holy Scriptures and nurture him in faith and prayer so that he may learn to trust God, proclaim Christ through word and deed, care for others and the world God made, and work for justice and peace among all people. Brandon and Kayla, as baptismal sponsors, do you promise to nurture Harvey in the Christian faith and help him to live in the covenant of his baptism and in communion with the church? If so, please answer, we do. People of God, do you promise to support Harvey and pray for him in his new life in Christ? Parents, sponsors, and all gathered here in worship, I ask you to reject sin, profess your faith in Christ, and confess the faith of the church. Do you renounce the devil and all the forces that defy God, the powers of this world that rebel against God, and the ways of sin that draw you away from God? Let us confess our faith together. Do you believe in God the Father? I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God? I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe in God, the Holy Spirit? I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give God our thanks and praise. We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning your Spirit brooded over the waters, and you created the world by your word, calling forth life in which you took delight. Through water you led your people Israel from slavery in Egypt to freedom in the promised land. In the waters of the Jordan, Jesus was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By the baptism of Jesus' death and resurrection, you delivered us from the power of sin and death and set us free to live in you. Send your Holy Spirit upon this water and upon all who are washed in it, that they may be given new life. To you be given honor and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. All right. Lower him over the ball. Harvey Douglas Radloff, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You can lift him up so he's cooked. Alleluia, alleluia. Perfect. Let us pray. We give you thanks, O God, that through water and the Holy Spirit, you give your daughters and sons new birth, wash them from sin, and raise them to eternal life. Sustain Harvey with the gift of your Holy Spirit, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the Spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever. Amen. Could you trace a cross on his forehead? Harvey Douglas, child of God, you have been sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever. Wonderful, thank you. And Brandon, do you want to come light the candle? Perfect. You can go stand over there. Perfect, thank you, Brandon. Harvey, walk in the faith of Christ crucified and risen. Shine with the light of Christ. Through baptism, you have been received into the household of God, entrusted with the good news of Jesus Christ, and strengthened to serve by the Holy and life-giving Spirit. We welcome you into the body of Christ and the mission we share. Join us as we give praise to God and bear God's creative and redeeming word to all the world. Please join me in welcoming our newest brother in Christ, Harvey Douglas. We will continue with the prayers.
Confident of your care and helped by the Holy Spirit, we pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. Merciful God, your reign is revealed to us in common things. A mustard shrub, a woman baking bread, a fishing net. Help your church witness to the surprising yet common ways you encounter us in daily life. Lord, in your mercy, When your word is opened, it gives light and understanding. Increase our understanding and awe of your creation. Guide the work of scientists and researchers. Treasuring the earth, may we live as grateful and healing caretakers of our home. Lord, in your mercy. As the birds of the air nest in branches of trees, gather the nations of the world into the welcoming shade of your merciful reign. Direct leaders of nations to build trust with each other and walk in the way of peace. Lord, in your mercy. Your Spirit helps us in our weakness and intercedes for the saints according to your will. Help us when we do not know how to pray. Give comfort to the dying, refuge to the weary, justice to those who are oppressed, and healing to the sick. We pray especially for those affected by Hurricane Hanna in Texas and Mexico, and for those who are allowed or in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy, you show steadfast love and direct us to ask of you what we need. Help this congregation ask boldly for what is most needed. Refresh us with new dreams of being your people in this time and place. Lord, in your mercy. In you, our lives are never lost. Strengthen us with the inspiring witness of your people in all times and places. Embolden our witness now, and one day gather us with all your saints in light. Lord, in your mercy. In the certain hope that nothing can separate us from your love, we offer these prayers to you through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Invite you to share the peace with each other. For those gathered for Harvey's baptism, you can share the peace with each other. Or those online, share the peace with a text or a message to one another, and peace be with all of you. And now let us give thanksgiving for the word. Let us pray. Praise and thanks to you, Holy God, for by your word you made all things. You spoke light into darkness, called forth beauty from chaos, brought life into being. For your word of life, O God, we give you thanks and praise. By your word you called your people Israel to tell of your wonderful gifts, freedom from captivity, water on the desert journey, a pathway home from exile. wisdom for life with you. For your word of life, O God, we give you thanks and praise. Through Jesus, your word made flesh, you speak to us and call us to witness. Forgiveness through the cross, life to those entombed by death, the way of your self-giving love. For your word of life, O God, we give you thanks and praise. Send your spirit of truth, O God, rekindle your gifts within us. Renew our faith, increase our hope, deepen our love for the sake of a world in need. Faithful to your word, O God, draw near to all who call on you. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory forever. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray together as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now receive God's blessing for the day. Neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. God the Creator, Jesus the Christ, and the Holy Spirit the Comforter bless you